The Duke had followed Carruthers up the ladder to his own bridge cabin, where he removed his oilskins and revealed himself to be an officer of captain's rank. Taking a key from his pocket, he opened the dispatch box and the envelope it contained, ran his eyes swiftly over the secret instructions, replaced them in the box, locked it, and then locked the box up in his safe, after which he went out onto the bridge and gave orders for a new course to be set. The half-flotilla of destroyers had disappeared over the horizon, and as a signal fluttered out from the halyards of the liner, the whole convoy wheeled round. De Richelieu saw that it had now turned west by south. The manoeuvre was, he guessed, evidently a deliberate policy on the part of the Admiralty to ensure that no one who had been in the escort ship should be able to give away the direction in which the convoy was moving after they had left it. The Duke kept Captain Carruthers constantly in view. Having given the order for the change of course, Carruthers spoke to no one. The Duke formed the impression that he was not the type to give anything away by casual talk. It looked as if the Nazi spy, if there was one on board, gained his information by securing access to the orders when the captain was not about, and any such attempt might not take place for several hours. De Richelieu began to look about for signs of Marie-Lou or Simon. He was conscious of an urge to get back to his own body. It was just after 10 when Marie-Lou silently appeared beside him. She had purposely retained in her astral form the features which De Richelieu knew in Earth life, so that he should have no difficulty in recognizing her, but she was considerably taller than her mortal self, and under the yachting cap which she was wearing, he noted that she had given herself golden hair instead of her chestnut curls. Both were naturally invisible and soundless to the men on the bridge near them, but their astrals could speak to each other in their normal voices. "Do you like me as a blonde?" He considered her carefully. "Yes, not better, but as well." "And you would be totally enchanting whatever colour hair you had."
"I suppose nothing's happened yet."
"No, nothing. Carruthers is the name of the man commanding the convoy. He's the rather red-faced fellow over there, standing on his own at the port side of the bridge, staring out across the water. Directly he got back on board with his orders, he opened them up, read them, and put them in his safe, which is near the head of his bunk inside his bridge cabin. Except to give the officer of the watch a new course, he hasn't spoken to a soul yet. So up to the moment, he remains the only person in the whole convoy who knows the route that it has been ordered to take." At that moment, Simon joined them.
"Well, how are things?" he asked.
"I've just been telling Marie-Lou. The orders are in the safe, and no one has yet seen them except the captain, and he hasn't passed them on to anyone else. So for the time being, your job is a very straightforward one. All you have to do is to watch the safe and the captain."
"Right. We'll take over then, and you'd better get back. We'll expect to see you again at about 7 o'clock this evening."
"That's it. But if you see anyone about to start any funny business, you're both to summon me at once with all the force of your wills, and I shall join you as quickly as I can." As he finished speaking, his astral faded, and they knew that he had returned to his mortal body at Cardinal's Folly. The day was grey and dreary. At 10:30, Captain Carruthers talked for a little with his second-in-command, but he made no mention of the route that the convoy had been ordered to take. By 11:30, the sun had come out, so the navigating officer was able to get his midday observation without any difficulty. When he had worked out the ship's position, he reported to Carruthers, who ordered a slight change of course which turned the convoy a few degrees further to southward. At 1 o'clock, the captain lunched in solitary state, and immediately afterwards, fully dressed, he lay down on his bunk to sleep. As the afternoon wore on, Simon and Marie-Lou became thoroughly bored with their job, but they did not relax their vigilance. De Richelieu arrived at 7 o'clock, and they told him that they had nothing to report. Night had now fallen, and all three of them were standing out in the black darkness of the bridge. The Duke was just about to tell the others that they could return home when he suddenly shivered and looked about him quickly. Astral bodies are not affected by the weather conditions of Earth, but astral forms do feel the cold or heat natural to any astral phenomena which may be in their vicinity. Do either of you feel anything unusual?
Yes, it seems to be getting awfully cold.
There's quite a wind blowing from somewhere, and it can't be an Earth wind. There must be something pretty nasty passing near us at the moment.
It may be passing, but somehow I don't think so. For the time being, you two had better remain with me. He knew that abominable wind to be a certain indication of the presence of disembodied evil. With a sudden absolute conviction that his theory was right, the Nazis were using the occult. Come on, quick! This is the thing for which we've been waiting. Now that the presence of the unknown evil could be so definitely felt, de Richelieu knew that the astral which was working for the Nazis might appear at any moment. If they remained as they were, the astral would see them, and if it realized that they were spying on it, would either make off or give battle according to its power. In either case, they would be robbed of the opportunity of seeing how it did its work. So as they passed into the captain's cabin, de Richelieu, knowing that his companions could not raise themselves to a higher level of consciousness, told them to change their forms. As he spoke, he became a fly, and they immediately followed suit. Carruthers was seated at a wall desk with a ledger opened up in front of him. His steward came in to lay the table, and dinner was served, but the captain did not seem to have much of an appetite. He sat there for some time over each course and appeared deep in thought. After dinner, Carruthers lay down on his bunk while the table was cleared and the cabin tidied. For the best part of an hour, the intense cold had continued unabated, and it was well past 8 when the captain rolled off his bunk and, crossing the cabin to the safe, began to fumble for his keys. De Richelieu signed to his two companion flies to come near him so that all three of them, by standing with their legs just touching, could increase their resistance should the evil entity actually appear now that the critical moment was come. Carruthers got the safe open, pulled out the dispatch box, unlocked it, and took out the convoy route order. Carrying it over to his bunk, he sat down with the instructions in his hand and began to reread them. The cold had now become positively icy, and Simon felt himself absolutely dropping with desire to fall awake. But at a slight pressure from the Duke, he roused and saw that something was moving just above the captain's head. Next minute, the thing was plain to all three of them. It was a thick-lipped negroid face, behind which a high-domed head and powerful shoulders began to materialize. Instantly they realized that this was the enemy astral, and that he was now memorizing the convoy route as the captain held it open in his hand. Within a split second, de Richelieu had changed himself into a great blue dragonfly of the highly poisonous variety. Almost as quickly, Marilou converted herself into a fat black and yellow queen wasp. Together, they launched themselves upon the Negro, while Simon, whose processes on the astral were much slower, was still struggling to equip himself suitably for participation in such a battle. The negroid astral must have sensed the presence of an enemy. He suddenly changed form, becoming a huge black flying beetle, which zoomed up to the roof of the cabin so that the dragonfly and the queen wasp shot past underneath him. Dropping like a plummet, he would have severed Marilou's pointed tail with his powerful pincers, had not Simon, in the guise of a hornet, come hurtling towards him at that instant. The four winged astrals circled about one another with amazing speed. The three bright champions of light endeavoured to pierce the beetle's guard and bury their stings in his body, but his back was armoured. so they could not get at him from above, and each time they darted at him, he drove them off with swift slashes of his formidable knife-like claws. Suddenly, the beetle changed, swelling in size, and assuming the appearance of a large black bird with a vulture-like beak. One snap of that beak would have cut any of his three enemies in half, and his movements were so swift that Marilou and Simon had to zip with lightning speed to sanctuary and corners among the white-painted girders where the great bird could not get at them. The Duke changed to a golden eagle, and one slash of his strong claws tore half a dozen feathers out of the black vulture's tail. The bird screeched with rage, and next second was gone from the cabin with the eagle sailing swiftly in pursuit. Both Simon and Marilou knew that they were leaving Earth to continue this astral battle in other spheres, and converting themselves into powerful feathered creatures, they made off in the track of the two birds. Captain Carruthers had not seen or heard the faintest indication of that strange fight which had raged within a few feet of his head, and he was still sitting there holding the open order, evidently conscientiously committing its contents to memory. The evil entity led them to a dark country on the astral plane, which has no replica on Earth. It was a place of black mountains and great gorges, yet it had a tropical richness of strange verdure in its valleys. Many of the plants were forms of cactus, others were like huge toadstools. Instead of grass, the ground was covered with poison ivy and fly-eating plants, and the whole of this thick vegetation swarmed with poisonous insects and reptiles. Suddenly the vulture dropped like a stone and disappeared among the leprous-looking foliage. De Richelieu plunged after it and was lost to sight. The other two then knew that unless they were to lose their quarry, they must assume forms which would enable them to follow through the seemingly impenetrable tangle of hideous undergrowth. Marilou again became a queen wasp, and Simon, with a great effort of his tired will, changed back into a hornet. They flew between the needle-like cactus spines and darted in and out among the giant funguses until they reached a small stony clearing where a terrible conflict was raging. A whirl of claws, sharp teeth, fur, legs, and tails made it impossible to distinguish at first which of the two animals was the Duke and the evil astral. And the difficulty was increased by the fact that the two beasts changed their forms a dozen times in 60 seconds. After an agonized snarl, one beast detached itself from the other, and whipping away, slithered swiftly along the rock in the form of a king cobra, by which the two watchers at once knew that this must be the enemy. But in an instant, De Richelieu had changed into a mongoose and was after the snake like a flash of light. The cobra reared up, hissed, and stabbed with its heavy, bespeckled head, but missed. The mongoose got its teeth into the snake's scaly body. The victim's tail began to thresh, but it drew in, changed form, and became one of the many great hairy legs of a huge tarantula. In an instant, the mongoose had become an armadillo whose thick armor protected it from the tarantula's poisonous bite. Suddenly, the tarantula seemed to disappear, but the armadillo routed furiously among the loose stones and narrowly escaped being stung in the foot by a baby scorpion. With a swift flick, the armadillo half crushed the scorpion beneath a stone, but it changed into a crab that increased in size with extraordinary rapidity, forcing the stone upwards with its great back of solid shell, and at the same time seizing the armadillo's long snout between one pair of its powerful pincers. The armadillo gave a screaming grunt, but Simon shot forward like a golden bullet and buried his hornet's sting into the soft part of the crab's great body. It made no sound, but its bulbous eyes on their long stalks jerked upward, and it released its grip as the armadillo turned back into an eagle, having prevented its snout from being severed by the swift transformation of it into a steely beak. For a moment, the eagle circled above the crab and then swooped to attack its eyes. But the crab had changed into a great black panther, which bounded into the air to meet the eagle's onrush. At that, Marilou took the form of a lion. As she sprang, all three of them went down in a whirling ball of fur and feathers, while Simon, unable to change himself so easily as the others, gyrated above them in frantic circles. The panther, bested by his two powerful antagonists, the King of Beasts and the King of Birds, saved itself by shrinking and a quick transformation into a deadly little black widow spider. Both the lion and the eagle jerked away from it. Next second, it was a hare, which bounded from them with such speed that they were compelled to disintegrate their astrals again into dragonfly and queen wasp in order to keep up with it. Simon had now utterly exhausted all his powers of sleep. Although he fought with all his will to continue the pace, he found himself dropping behind, and that the scene of those grim valleys was fading. Next moment, he shuddered and was awake. Derishlo outdistanced the hare, resumed the form of an eagle, and suddenly pounced upon it, but the hare swerved, evaded the striking beak, and raced on. Next moment, it had gone underground. Marilou knew now what was ahead of them, and it was one of the tests which she loathed and dreaded more than anything else on the astral plane. They would have to follow through some long, narrow tunnel far below the soil, with the awful feeling that at any moment the tunnel would cave in upon them and that they would be buried alive. She knew perfectly well that in her astral form that could not occur, but it was a fear which she carried over with her from her dread as a mortal and had not yet conquered, as it was nonetheless real. Steeling herself to the ordeal, she followed the Duke's example, changed herself into a ferret, and disappeared after him down the hole. The tunnel was only just large enough for them to wriggle along it, and it was useless for them to reduce their size, because each time they did so, the evil thing ahead caused the walls of the tunnel to close in round them. It was abominably hot and stuffy, and the darkness was impenetrable even to their astral eyes, because they were surrounded by what, for lack of a better term, may be called astral matter, through which it was beyond their powers to see, and down in that foul warren the air was poisonous with the stench of decaying bodies. The chase seemed interminable, and hardly a minute passed without both the pursuers having the impression that they were stuck underground and could go no further. Only the extreme exercise of their willpower enabled them to do so. Suddenly, Marilou caught a muffled shout of warning from the Duke, and almost instantly he was swept back upon her as a strong current of water rushed against them and submerged them both. They gasped, and for a moment knew the first horror of drowning in an underground cavern, until they turned themselves into fish and determinedly struck forward against the current. As they darted along, Marilou caught a thought that Derishlo sent out to encourage her. We're wearing him down. He must be tiring, or he would never have used that trick. And a little further on, the tunnel broadened until it grew in width to a great cleft, which came out underwater in a cave faintly lit by daylight. The second they debouched into it, the slimy tentacles of a huge octopus seized them, but both had the same inspiration and changed themselves before they could be crushed into electric eels. The giant squid released them as swiftly as it had seized upon them and disappeared in a cloud of inky fluid which it shot out to cover its retreat, but Derishlo was after it in the form of a swordfish, while Marilou quickly turned herself into a shark. As they darted towards the entrance of the cavern, they could see by the full daylight, which now percolated through the greenish waters, the red coral fans and the brilliant coloured fish beneath them. During a few anxious moments, they lost the octopus, but just in time, Marilou saw it shrink into a tiny shrimp and, darting forward, snapped at it with her huge jaws. For a second, the shrimp was actually in her mouth. But before she could crush it between her seven rows of teeth, it slipped out again and began to swell to giant proportions, assuming the form of a vast hammerhead whale. The great beast had only a tiny gullet, so could not attack either opponent successfully with its mouth, but by threshing wildly it sought to smash them with its tail. Marilou buried her sharp teeth in one of its fins, but de Richelieu again sent out the mental message to her, calling her off with the words, "Keep away from him, and he can't harm us. Now that he's on the defensive, we've got him beaten, but we must stick to him until we find out where he goes." While the whale plunged in and out of the waves like some gargantuan porpoise, churning the waters into foam, they drew off a little. Then the black astral, apparently realizing that he could not overcome them, suddenly left the water to take his human form. As the seascape dissolved, they saw him far above them, a brawny negro clad in white, with a row of human skulls tied about his girdle and several necklaces of shark's teeth about his neck. They had no means of knowing if this was the earthly form of their antagonist or just another disguise which his astral had adopted, but they instantly changed themselves into humans equipped for battle on the astral plane and gave chase. With incredible swiftness, another scene opened up before them, and they knew that this was no astral creation, but that they had returned to some portion of Earth. Far below them, set in a gently moving sea, was a great promontory of land. The towns were widely scattered, and the villages few and far between. Inland there were rugged mountains in the higher parts, and the beaches appeared long and desolate. So much they could see with their astral sight, but they knew that, in fact, this land was still shrouded in the darkness of night. As they raced on, they came over a great bay which in shape was not unlike a widely opened lobster claw. It was then, high above the deserted beach, that their enemies suddenly turned and charged at them. De Richelieu met the shock, and momentarily went down under it, his will failing him to resist the power of his dark adversary. But Marilou had not encountered evil entities on her previous astral journeys during many centuries without learning something about them. She knew that except in very rare cases they have the lusts of humans. In consequence, with one swift thought, she changed herself from a warrior of the light into her own earthly form, and appeared there, dazzlingly beautiful and stark naked. The big negro's eyes glinted redly. He half released the Duke and stretched out a great hand to grab her, but she slipped away, and the second's respite was enough for de Richelieu to recover. Another second, and Marilou was back again in her form of a young warrior, and at the same instant she and the Duke flung themselves upon the adversary. He gave back in desperate fear as they seized upon him to bind him and hurl him into hell. In his extremity he used the only remedy left to him, and called aloud in an ancient tongue upon his satanic master. As his scream for help rent the air, it seemed as though a dark cloud was forming and rising up from the land below, and de Richelieu knew that all the followers of the left-hand path in that place were hurrying to the assistance of their hard-pressed confrère. Against such odds, he and Marilou were utterly powerless. Too late, he realized that having driven the evil entity into a corner, they had been guilty of the most frightful rashness. And as the hosts of Satan rushed upon them, he was terribly aware that it might now be beyond their powers to save themselves. Even on Earth, thought processes can be incredibly rapid, so that the human brain is capable of covering an enormous amount of ground in the space of a few seconds. Yet this is slow compared with the speed with which an intelligence on the astral, being entirely free of matter, can carry out its mental functions. In a split second, de Richelieu was conscious of many things. Here, the knowledge acquired in life after life gradually piles up, so that once an individual has been an adept, although the mysteries may be obscured from him for whole incarnations, each time the spark is rekindled, the reacquisition of the previous knowledge he has gained is an infinitely easier process. No one, while in the physical body, can hope to become fully conscious of his true astral life without having spent many previous incarnations in training to accomplish that end. Yet Earth is now so old that there are few of us who have not done so at one period or another, which makes the reacquisition of this knowledge by no means impossible, providing that we work for it with real determination. But it must not be forgotten that the whole vast scheme of things is planned like some great university. If a man, having spent 6 terms studying history at Oxford, then decided to go in for maths, and spent a further 2 years immersed in the study of higher mathematics, should he at the end of that time suddenly be called upon to do a paper on history, it would not be surprising if his history proved distinctly rusty. The same applies in the cosmic university, where each life on Earth is no more than a term, and life itself, in its true astral sense, is everlasting. It was many incarnations since de Richelieu had devoted several Earth lives in succession to the serious study of such occult knowledge as is ever permitted to humans. Although he could still perform minor feats of magic, it was many centuries since he had practiced as a powerful white magician, and he had temporarily forgotten much that he had originally learnt in connection with the higher mysteries. He now realized that the present was literally a case of having rushed in where angels fear to tread. His belief that the Nazis were using the occult was proved, but he had visualized them as employing an occultist with only limited powers, such as his own, or working through a trance medium, whereas it was now clear that they had in their service some great master of the left-hand path. With a nation of 80 million Germans, all the black elements in which would automatically be in sympathy with the Nazis, it was only natural that they should employ a number of adepts of the first rank. As the satanic host rose up from the dark sea-washed shore, the Duke knew that to summon such a force, his opponent must be a Magister Templi at the very least. Their slender chance of saving themselves lay in instant flight. "Back to your body," he called, and turning together they fled with every ounce of speed of which they were capable. The seconds that followed seemed years of nightmare battling to the pursued. The forces of evil brought all their powers to bear, seeking to strike them down with astral missiles, striving to drag them back by the exertion of malignant will, and casting up in front of them every form of astral barrier which might terrify and check them. Instead of the effortless flight to which they were accustomed, they felt as though their astral bodies were weighted with lead. A frightful storm arose in which they were tossed about like thistledown in a gale. Forked lightning streaked the sky, while incessant peals of thunder vibrated through the air like an intensive bombardment. Both the fugitives knew that these were only manifestations which could not harm them provided they remained unafraid and kept their faith and purpose. Suddenly, they were faced by a great wall of fire which had neither top nor bottom. The wall was like the interior of a furnace, and one vast mass of solid, white-hot matter which glowed, bubbled, and hissed, giving out a blinding light and a heat so intense that it seemed to shrivel up their astral bodies. Marilou faltered and stopped, but de Richelieu knew that if they did not succeed in getting back to their bodies, they would die in their sleep. That was part of the price they would pay for having gone out against evil powers stronger than themselves. Seizing her by the arm, he dragged her with him straight into the glowing mass. For a second, the pain was practically unendurable. Then the fiery wall dissolved. The roaring of the flames gave place to a quietness which could almost be felt. Gasping with relief, they both threw back the bedclothes and sat up to find Richard, Rex, and Simon kneeling beside them in the pentacle with their heads bowed in prayer. At the sound of their waking, Richard opened his eyes and grabbed Marilou to him.
"Thank God you're back. Simon told us, and I've been half crazy with fear for you ever since he woke up."
Simon looked at the Duke. "I'll never forgive myself for having had to leave you in a muddle, but, well, I just couldn't keep asleep." De Richelieu laid a hand on Simon's arm.
My dear fellow, don't be absurd. I thought you put up a marvellous performance in sticking it so long. I'll wager you can't remember when you last managed to sleep for 11.5 hours in one stretch, and you saved me from that brute when in the form of a crab he had me by the nose. Richard had put a bed jacket about Marie Lou's shoulders, but in spite of that and the warmth of the room, she shivered as she said,
"Although we have just come through the fiery furnace, I am still desperately cold."
"We'll soon remedy that," smiled the Duke. "What we both want is a good meal. I'm not going out again until I've had a chance to relearn certain of the more powerful methods of protection. In the meantime, it will do us all good to live like normal human beings for a spell." Rex laughed. "What a cocktail I'll shake for you all this evening." They unanimously agreed that the best of all meals would be an unlimited supply of ham and eggs, to be followed by pancakes. While Rex and Simon laid the kitchen table, Marie Lou cooked the ham and eggs, de Richelieu prepared the batter for the pancakes, and Richard disappeared down to the cellar to return with a couple of magnums of champagne. "What's the drill now?" Rex asked. "The Nazis are using the occult. Our next problem is to find in the flesh the black occultist who is working for them. We must kill him."
"Now, how do you suppose to set about the job of finding him?" asked Richard.
"We know that he's a Negro, a black witch doctor, and there can't be many people of that kind in Germany," said Rex. "And you can travel to Germany in your astrals, but as long as you're on the astral plane yourselves, you can't kill a human. So what's the big idea? Do you figure an hour trying to get into Germany in the flesh?"
"It looks as if we may have to. And with Sir Pellinore's assistance, I don't doubt that some of us could get through.
I think, though, that Rex is wrong in assuming that the person we are after is necessarily a Negro. The probability is that he only assumed that form when we saw him. It's much more likely that in the flesh he is a fair-haired, blue-eyed Hun. There's one thing we know quite definitely. He comes from an island in which part of the coast is shaped rather like a lobster's claw with blunt ends. That was unquestionably a portion of this earth, and if I saw it again, or even the outline of it on a map, I should recognize it. Our enemy may quite well be operating from one of the islands in the Baltic or on the Norwegian coast."
"That's it!" exclaimed Marie Lou. "I remember that away from the shore, the country was very mountainous."
"So it was. We really need a set of large-scale maps, so tomorrow I'll go up to the Admiralty. In any case, I want to visit the British Museum to read up certain old key works on magic, which they are bound to have there, in order to renew my knowledge of protection." It was now well past 4 in the morning, so they decided to go to bed, but the Duke warned them. "From now on, you must sleep nowhere, even for an hour, except within the pentacle. And when you're asleep, your astrals must not go outside it." After lunch the next day, the Duke left them to motor to London, and he dined that night with Sir Pellinore and asked for arrangements to be made at the Admiralty so that he could examine the large-scale charts of the coast of Northern Europe. Sir Pellinore now treated the question with the utmost gravity. Having had some time to think over what de Richelieu had told him of the occult, and having since taken the opportunity to hold several long conversations with other people who were interested in the subject, he had formed the conclusion that de Richelieu's theory was by no means as improbable as it at first sounded. De Richelieu therefore found him very much more subdued, interested, and willing to consider further possible developments than he had expected, and the visit to the Admiralty was arranged for the following morning without any trouble. Next day, the Duke spent over 3 hours with a lieutenant commander who was a map expert in one of the chart rooms at the Admiralty, but he could not discover any island or promontory which had the same coastal formation as that which he and Marie Lou had seen in their hours of peril.
He obtained permission from one of the curators of the British Museum to study certain priceless old manuscripts which were removed specially for him from the vaults. For the best part of 3 days he devoted himself to these ancient screeds, making copious notes from them. He then paid a visit to Culpeper House in Bruton Street and purchased a strange assortment of items from the famous herbalists. On the 4th day he lunched with Sir Pellinore. When he'd reported his lack of success at the Admiralty, the baronet asked him what he intended to do. "I must go out again and utilize every means in my power to discover the identity of this person who is acting for the Nazis on the astral plane. Whoever he is, and wherever he is, we've got to find him and kill him." Sir Pellinore nodded.
"You're setting yourself no small task, and I wish I could thank you officially on behalf of the government, but quite honestly, they'd think that I'd gone off my rocker if I attempted to tell them of the extraordinary work you're doing. However, I'm sure it'll be a great satisfaction to you to know that I heard this morning that the convoy has so far remained immune from attack and is now outside the danger area." When the Duke got back to Cardinal's Folly that night, he found his 4 friends seated in glum silence in the drawing room, but immediately he entered that they all started to talk at once. From the night of his departure to London, the house had been rendered almost untenable by what Richard described as a whole company of poltergeists. They smashed china, tore the curtains, threw water upon the beds, slammed doors until the sound had driven nearly everybody crazy, and performed innumerable other acts of mischief each night while darkness lasted. On the 2nd day, the servants had left in a body, with the exception of Richard's faithful butler valet, Malin. "I was afraid of something of this sort," confessed Richelieu, and he looked at Marie-Lou contritely. "I can't say how sorry I am to have brought such trouble to your house, Princess."
"Don't worry, Grey Eyes, dear. At least it gives us the feeling that we're doing our bit."
"I take it they haven't started on the physical plane? None of you have been attacked while walking in the grounds or seen any suspicious-looking strangers about?"
"There were a couple of men this morning," Richard began, but left his sentence unfinished.
At that instant there was a sound of crashing glass as something hurtled through the window. Next second there rolled from beneath the curtains a large, round, black object. One glance at it was enough. With a horrid sinking feeling, they all recognized it to be a high-explosive bomb. Next second there was a deafening roar. The whole house shook. The Duke and Simon were hurled off their feet. The armchair in which Marie-Lou was lying, with Richard spread-eagled on top of her, was thrown over sideways, and they both rolled across the floor. After a moment, the darkness lightened. Some of the burning logs had been blown onto the hearth, and a few embers had fallen on the Persian rugs. There was a strong smell of burning.
"Darling, are you all right?"
Richard's voice came, frantic with anxiety.
"Yes, yes. But you, are you hurt?"
"No, no, no. Simon, Grey Eyes, where are you?"
"Here,"
Simon replied. But from the Duke, there was no reply. A moment later they heard Malin calling from the doorway.
"Mr. Richard, sir, madam, what's happened? Are you hurt?"
"No, Malin, no, but I'm afraid His Grace is. Quick, get a light, some candles." "Where's Rex? Rex, where the hell are you?"
Marie-Lou answered,
"He's not here. He was standing near the door and I saw him spring through it into the hall just before the bomb exploded."
Malin returned at that moment, carrying some lighted candles. The bomb had blown the whole of the lower portion of the bookcase to smithereens, and its top part, together with the books which had cascaded from it, lay in the centre of the room, a scattered heap, with the armchair overturned beneath it. They saw that the Duke was lying pinned beneath the armchair and half buried under a pile of books. Now that they could see properly, they were soon able to get to work, and within a few moments had dragged him clear.
They found that he was breathing, and although he had been badly cut about the face by flying glass from the bookcase, they could find only one other wound upon him, which was in his right foot.
"We'd better take him to the library," said Richard, "and put him in the pentacle. Otherwise some of these swine may get him on the astral while he's unconscious."
Marie-Lou came hurrying in with a basin of hot water, towels, and bandages. She sponged the blood from the cuts onto Richelieu's face, and soon afterwards he came round. They found that a tiny fragment of the bomb had torn its way through the flesh at the side of his foot. The wound was painful, but it did not appear that any of the tendons were cut, so they considered that they had all come off very lightly. There was a sound of trampling feet in the hall, and Rex's voice shouting directions. Then a little man staggered into the library, bowed almost double under the weight of a taller man whom he was carrying slung across his shoulders. Rex entered triumphantly behind them. With his mighty hand he gave the man in front of him a swift push, which sent the fellow and his burden sprawling to the floor.
"I got 'em. Got both the devils. They were standing around waiting to come in after the pineapple went off, to make certain that they'd rubbed us out."
One was a short, wiry-looking little Japanese. The other, who was still unconscious, was a tall, thin, sallow-faced European. De Richelieu, who had recovered a little, sat up to question the prisoners. He found that in his groggy state the job was too much for him, so Marie-Lou insisted that he should lie down and leave it to the others. The European prisoner soon came round sufficiently for them to heave him to his feet. It was decided that both of them should be locked up in one of the numerous cellars which lay under the older wing of Cardinal's Folly. Richard led the way out, while Rex shepherded his charges along with ungentle prods, and Simon went off with Marie-Lou to help her to prepare dinner. Soon after the friends had sat down to table, the Duke said, "I doubt if they know anything about the astral side of the business. Our real adversary will have communicated with the head of the Nazi spy system in Britain and asked that we should be eliminated. These two thugs were detailed to do the job, but I should think it most unlikely that they have the least idea as to why they were ordered to murder us." They could hear a door slamming somewhere in the west wing. It kept on banging rhythmically about every 30 seconds. "Let's make a move," said the Duke. "Tomorrow, when I'm feeling stronger, I'll perform a banishing ritual and try to get rid of these things for you. They're not dangerous in themselves, and are quite a low form of elemental sent by our enemy to annoy us, so I don't think there should be any great difficulty in driving them away." As he limped off to the library with Marie-Lou and Simon to prepare the great pentacle for the night, Richard and Rex lit candles and together descended into the cellars of the house. One of them was used as a wine cellar and two others for lumber, but a fourth was empty, and it was into this that Richard had locked the two enemy agents. Taking a huge key from its nail beside the door, he unlocked it, and holding their candles aloft, they went in. Richard addressed the prisoners in a hard, cold voice. "Listen, both of you. This is my house. There are no servants here, and no one will come down to these cellars whatever happens. You can shout until you have no voices left, but nobody will hear you. And if you persist in forgetting how to talk, I mean to forget that I've ever set eyes on either of you. This cellar, as you see, is absolutely empty. There's no food and no water in it, and not even a bed on which to lie down. What is more, the stone floor is damp and cold. If you persist in refusing to answer my questions, my friend and I will leave you here, and we shall not come back. No food and no water will be brought to you, so in the course of a day or two you will die of thirst, and a very unpleasant form of death you will find it. Now, are you going to be sensible, or do you prefer to die here?" Both the prisoners maintained a sullen silence, and Rex said, "That line's no good, Richard. At least it won't get us anywhere at the moment. They'd probably stick it for 24 hours anyhow before they decided to spill the beans. We'll have to try something else if we want quick results.
I know how we can hasten matters, Richard said. Whatever we get out of them, we shan't be able to make use of it until tomorrow morning. And in any case, we ought to search their clothes to see if they have anything of interest on them. Let's strip them both and leave them here in the cold all night. I'll bet they'll be ready enough to talk by the time we've had our breakfast.
Good stunt, that. And if they die of pneumonia afterwards, what the hell? Better folk than they are dying as we stand here as a result of Nazi air raids. For the sake of a blanket and a cup of hot soup tomorrow, they'll be ready to give their own mothers away. Carefully setting their candles down on the floor near the door, they advanced upon the Japanese. In vain, the Japanese squirmed and kicked. Between them, they ripped off every shred of his clothes and flung him gasping in a corner. They advanced upon the European, who lay moaning on the floor. Rex set him up, and Richard pulled off his coat. It was at that moment that Richard caught sight of something which made his blood turn to water in his veins. It was a tiny blob of purplish-red light, about as big as a firefly, hovering near the ceiling. This little glimmer of red light might be only a low form of elemental. On the other hand, it might be some terrible Saatii manifestation from the outer circle which had come on the scene to protect the two thugs who were pawns in this physical game.
Rex, quick, get out!
Richard sprang away from the man whose clothes he'd been removing. Rex instantly swung round and saw the thing behind him. Even in that brief space of time, the reddish glow had increased from the size of a peanut to that of a golf ball. The radiance it gave up was much brighter. Simultaneously, both of them flung themselves at the door and wrenched it open. As they did so, the candles fluttered out. Yet the cellar was not plunged in darkness. The lurid red glow now lit the whole place, and the manifestation had swollen to the size of a cricket ball. Sweating with terror, they threw themselves out into the passage and started to run along it, but they both had the awful sensation that something was pulling them back. To lift each foot meant a colossal effort. It was as though they were trying to run underwater, and the dark passage stretched out before them, seeming to be 100 yards in length. Utilizing every ounce of their willpower, they fought their way forward until, when they were halfway along the passage, Rex gave a moaning cry, stumbled, and fell. Instinctively, Richard uttered the simple plea,
"Lord, protect us! Oh, Lord, protect us!"
And his call was answered. Somehow he managed to jerk Rex back onto his feet. They reached the foot of the stairs. The stairs appeared to stretch up and up into infinity. They were bent almost double, so that only the first few stairs came within the range of their vision.
O Lord, protect us! O Lord, protect us!
Richard whispered again, and with fresh effort they mounted the first 3 stairs, only to collapse side by side upon the fourth. A wave of reddish light seemed to pass over them, blinding them to all else. They were submerged in it, breathless, gasping. The beating of their hearts was labored, slowing down. Both felt that the end was upon them, when suddenly Simon's voice was calling from the top of the stairs,
"Richard! Rex!"
His shout was followed by a gasp of dismay as he saw them lying there huddled together. Then, in a ringing voice, he cried aloud the words,
"Fundamenta eius in montibus sanctis!"
Immediately, the magenta light faded. Their limbs were free of the awful weight which held them down, and next moment Simon, who had rushed down towards them, was dragging them both helter-skelter up the stairs. Breathless, shaking, and still chilled with the terror of the evil which had been upon them, they stumbled across the hall and into the library.